Hello to everyone, welcome to the MIDAS Expert webinar series. Today we will talk about composite bridges and how MIDAS Civil helped us in a feasibility study regarding the project of an overpass. If you have any questions, please contact MIDAS Bridge at midasit.com. I am Guglielmo Matacena, I am a civil engineer specializing in structures and geotechnics. Years ago, I started working in Bucharest at Itarom, focusing my work on bridge design. Itarom Ingegneria is a company specialized in the design of infrastructures that has been and still is involved in many big projects of bridges and viaducts. Itarom is a part of a bigger group called ITR Engineering that is active in Romania, Poland, Italy and France. In the last year, we faced a feasibility study for the realization of an overpass in the zone of Sinaia in Romania. And the proposed solution was a composite steel concrete deck. In this webinar, we will analyze the steps that drove us in seeking a solution for a complex engineering problem due to the urban area in which the work is located and to the presence of an important road passing under the main span. Three solutions have been studied to adapt the structure to the environmental requirements. In particular, a double I girder solution, a single tab girder section, and finally a double tab girder one. Composite structures are characterized by a steel structure fixed to a concrete one so that both materials act together, reducing deflections and increasing strength. This is done using shear connectors fixed to the steel beams and then embedded in the concrete. Composite bridges are an efficient solution in terms of weight and cost for intermediate spans between 40 and 100 meters. Composite bridges have some important advantages, like the reduced weight in relation to its resistance, the ease of execution, its adaptability to different deck geometries, its aesthetic and architectonic quality, since it's clear looking at the structure what is the function of each part of the bridge, and the durability. The most common types commonly adopted are the double I girder and the tab or box girder. The double I solution is the simplest and its ratio L on H, that is the span length on the height of section, is in the order of 22-28. For closer sections, the ratio is about 50. The bridge is a part of a feasibility study aimed to realize an overpass in a populated area of Sinaia. Feasibility studies in the construction sector are preliminary studies done at the beginning of the project. Since construction projects requires a huge time and money investment, it is important to establish if the project will be feasible at the very early stage. The purpose of a feasibility study is to find the most appropriate solutions in economic and technical terms. The fact that the overpass is located near buildings and over an important intersection required a great attention, making the realization of the work an interesting engineering challenge. The first solution studied is a double I girder composite bridge that is the simplest and also the cheapest one. It is modeled as a simple supported beam with a single span of 55 meters. And in this model, the substructure is not taken into account and the deck is simulated with a grillage model. The type of bridge, the double I type of bridge, is the most common, and consists in two girders of I shape, with the generally cross beam not connected to the slab. Now we go into the analysis. So to our structure will be applied live loads like wind and temperature. Wind load is calculated according to Aero Code 114, Section 8. We have three directions for wind, but the most important is the lateral one, that is in X direction. We can use a simplified method proposed by the code, in which the wind force is function of air density, wind speed, of a factor that depends on the zone and the area of exposed surface. When wind is combined with traffic, a further area is considered because of the presence of vehicles. The Romanian code provides a map in which the wind pressure is already defined based on the zone in which the structure is located. For temperature loads too, Romanian aerocodes provide some maps that defines maximum and minimum temperature for each zone of the country. Knowing the zone and the type of deck and uses this graphic from the aerocode 115, we can find the uniform temperatures to apply to our elements in MIDAS. Other than the uniform component of temperature, we have to define also the temperature gradients caused by the difference of temperature between the exposed parts to the one in shield. The aerocode 115 gives some standard, some values that are applicable for composite bridges that are valid also for Romanian codes, and some corrective factors depending on the wearing surface of the deck. In this model, we are going to define loads due to traffic. The aerocode defines some rules for road bridges. The first thing is to define the notional lane depending on the width of the deck. In our case, we have for load model 1 a first lane of 3 meters and a remaining area of 1 meter and a half. For load model 1, we have a concentrated load of 300 kN for each X and a distributed load of 9 kN on square meters, while load model 2 requires a concentrated load of 400 kN per axe, and it's more important in short span bridges between 3 and 7 meters. The interesting thing is that with MIDAS we can variate the position of the loads with the influenced line theory and find the most onerous configuration using the mobile node optimization function that we will see in the model. These vertical traffic loads need to be combined with the horizontal traffic loads, creating this group of load that we see here, group 1A, group 1B, and group 2. The most important horizontal forces are braking or acceleration forces and the centrifugal force. The braking force is a fraction of the vertical load in the first lane of load model 1 and is applied at level of carriageway. The acceleration force instead has the same value but opposite longitudinal direction relative to the braking one. The centrifugal force is present in case of curved bridge and is a force acting at the level of carriageway in a perpendicular direction respect to the axis of a bridge. It is dependent on the radius of the curve and dependent also on the vertical traffic load of load model 1. Now let's give a look to the model. This model is a fully line element model that quite well simulates the behavior of a structure with a slab modeled as a series of cross beams with a rectangular section that we can see here with a width of 1 meter and a thickness of 22 centimeters. Also, we can see the main beams that have a slope of about the 6%. With a section, we can see here. They have a section, a composite I section, with a height of the steel beam of 1.35 meters and an effective width of the connected slab of 2.60 meters. Here in show calculation results, we also can see the center of the section. This is useful when we have to choose the offset of the for the correct application of the slab element. The beams have been divided, as we can see here, in elements of 1 meter's length to easily keep the control of distances along it. Now we go in top view, and So I can show the boundaries. Okay. The scheme has been chosen for allow the thermal expansions in both X and Y direction, releasing the degrees of freedom for this support in X direction, for the Y direction in this support, and both direction for the third one. The first is fixed. In this way, we prevent stresses due to uniform temperature load. We can see that in this model we didn't create the substructure. Now we can see the load applied. Okay, we have the permanent loads like self weight. We have the parapet load. That is an element load applied with an eccentricity. The pavement load that is applied directly on beams. Then we have wind load. We saw in the slides how to calculate it. This is applied on both horizontal direction, and it is applied with an eccentricity, as we can see here, considering the presence of vehicles on the carriageway. The uniform temperature load, now I can show you. Sorry. That is calculated with the uniform temperature is applied on every element present in the model, and is calculated with maps that we can find in the Romanian code. The gradient temperature is applied directly on beams. We have a positive one and a negative one depending on which one is the warmer side of the beam. The traffic effect has been modeled with the moving load optimization function. It's a traffic line lane for this model. The moving load optimization function automatically finds the most onerous disposition of the lanes in the transversal direction. In this project, we have a 4 meter and 0.5 of carriageway. And this model, in this model, we used the cross beam distribution of vehicles, since we create a group of a structural group that is made of beams of these transversal elements. Then called the vehicles considered are those defined by the aero codes, and here we can see also the C factors. That is that they are useful for apply frequent values for frequent combination of load model one, and we define the moving load cases. We define the characteristic load model one case. This is for to create the group 1A of the table that we have seen in the slides. Then a frequent one to combine with the horizontal traffic loads. In this case, we uncheck, ignore C factors, we consider it. And finally, LM2 useful for the group 1B. Let's see how now this horizontal traffic force. We have here braking loads. That is and the acceleration that is in the opposite direction. They are distributed in the longitudinal direction where the first lane is supposed to be. And centrifugal force, we also apply the centrifugal force to both beams. And this is applied because the bridge has a radius of curvature of 170 meters. All these horizontal forces are applied at the level of the carriageway, as required by the code. Now we can check the results. The analysis has been already run. We can see, for example, moving tracer. This is interesting. Moving tracer shows the most onerous disposition of traffic load for each element. This is also a sort of test for the accuracy of the model. For example, we want to see the configuration of frequent load for maximum moment of the element 80. The element 80 is placed at the center of the span. We include C factors. And this is the configuration of load model 1 frequent. We can see the reduced value of the axis, and that the most loaded part is in the center, as expected. Also, we can see, for example, the maximum effect in moment for LM2. It seems correct, and the LM1 characteristic. Also, we can see the resultant moment in beam forces moment. For example, we can see the effect of self weight on the structure. Okay. We see that the deformed shape is coherent. We have, for example, the effect of wind load on one side. Okay. And for example, we can test the temperature, uniform temperature. You can see if the disposition of supports as it worked. And we can, as we can see, we don't have bending moments due to the freedom of the bridge to expand. Okay, so on we can, for example, see the effect of the LM1 characteristic. And so on. And so we have seen the first model build, this is the simplest one. Now we come back to our PowerPoint. With the first model, considering the wall deck package, we reach a section of about 1.6 meters. Due to the presence of an underpassing intersection, we had a limited space. In addition, the ramp needed to be shortened since in the first version of the project it got too close to some buildings near the route. This further reduced the available clearance, making the first section no more suitable. The proposed solution was a continuous girder with a single tub section as main beam, still keeping a central span of 55 meters. Tub and box girders are more expensive and complex to realize. The difference between a box and a tub section is that the second one is opened in the upper part. These kind of sections have the advantage of a reduced height compared to the resistance, as well as a great resistance to torsion. Closed sections are economically viable only for reduced deck widths, and for our project seem to the perfect solution due to the limited space and the reduced dimensions of the bridge deck. In this phase, substructure has been modeled in MIDAS and the effect of the seism has been analyzed. The Romanian code P100 that is included in the program provides some maps to identify the location where the structure is and to obtain the values of the corner period TC and the acceleration of ground level AG. Knowing these two parameters, we have almost all ingredients to execute a response spectrum analysis. Error code 8 part 2 requires a behavior factor for limited ductile pyres equal to 1.5. Modal shapes have been combined in model through a complete quadratic combination, CQC, that is more suitable for multi-span bridges respect to SRSS that is more commonly used but tend to overestimate or underestimate the results in a system with close natural frequencies. As we said, the model is realized with a single composite section. We have three spans of 20, 55, and 20 meters. Since we will analyze the seismic behavior of the structure, it's important to check in the structure tab the convert self-weight into massive option. Here we can choose also to consider the masses as concentrated or distributed. We choose the distributed one, the consistent masses option that is for a more accurate model. The main girder is a composite steel type section. You can see here the properties. The total height of the steel part is 1.2 meters, while the wall slab is included directly in the section. Due to its width of nearly 3 meters, we had some T-stiffeners, you can see it here, in the bottom flange to prevent local buckling phenomenon. The pyres are modeled as a plate element, here,
with a thickness of 2 meters and fix it to the base, as we can see. The connection between the beam and substructure is realized with elastic links, freeing the longitudinal direction to allow the thermal expansion of the deck. In this model, we can see that we have applied permanent loads. Here we can see self-weight, sidewalk, that is the weight of the lateral part of the deck, and weighing surface. These loads have been converted in masses through the function load to masses. Yeah, you can see. Okay, they have been added here. In this way, we can take into account these forces in the response spectrum analysis. As for the previous one, in this model we use the moving load optimization to simulate the traffic loads. Moving load optimization, we create a carriageway. In this case, since the model has any transversal element and just a single girder, we choose the vehicular load distribution as a lane element. It's time to define the dynamic loads. We go in a rest function. We define two the response spectrum, one for horizontal direction, one for the vertical one. Here we choose the design spectrum. We have P100 as an option here, horizontal design spectrum here. And in the zone of Sinaia we have a TC equal to 0.7 and a ground acceleration of 0.3 g. This is the important factor. For a strategic structure, we choose 1.4, and the bureau factor, as we see in the slides, is 1.5. Okay, this is how the response spectrum functions appears. We also define the vertical design spectrum. Okay, the option is the same. Here we have to choose vertical design spectrum and use the same factors. Here is how it appears. We undefined also response spectrum load cases for the three directions of the seism. We have RSX with an XY direction here and the horizontal spectrum associated. RSY, that is the same of the first one, but you have an excitation angle of 90 degrees because it's a perpendicular direction. And the vertical component, RSZ, that has Z direction. Here we can choose the way we want to combine the modes. Preliminary operation before to define the RS load cases is to define the number of modes that you want to be considered by the program in the eigenvalue analysis options. Otherwise, here we won't have any mode to combine. We chose the CQC combination since we expect close natural frequencies between modes. Note that in the operation of combining modes, we lose signs. MIDAS gives the possibility to choose a method to assign them. Along the major mode direction uses the sign of the major mode in cases where the torsion is significant or the modes are closely spaced, it is more appropriate to use along the absolute maximum value option. In any case, in our project, we left this option unchecked, being more conservative and leaving resultant forces in absolute values. Now we can see some results since we have the model already run. Here we can check the model shape, here in vibration mode shapes. Activating the legend, we can see, for example, the frequency, the natural period, and the effective modal mass for each mode. Okay, let's give a look to this is the first mode. the second, and so on, we can see that the frequencies, the periods are quite close in this model. Now we can give a look to the forces, the forces moment for the girder actions. We can see, for example, the effect of the vertical seism on the moment. And for example, we can see the effect on pyres with plate forces moment. Pyres are M plate element. For example, we can see the horizontal action on the MXX direction. Here is the one we can see, for example, the shear force. Now we go back in the presentation because we are going to talk about buckling. Lateral torsional buckling is a serious topic for metallic structures, but in composite section, generally, the slab connected to the steel partially mitigate the problem, acting as a constraint for the section which is not free to deform laterally. However, there are two ways in this phenomenon can be dangerous for composite bridges. The first occurs in continuous bridges, where the negative moment can compress the lower flange that is not constrained by the slab. And the second one can occur during execution, when the steel section is alone and we are casting the concrete of the slab. The buckling resistance of the steel members depends on its slenderness. That is a function of the critical elastic moment. European codes provide some closed form solution for these. We can see them here. But they all refer to double symmetrical section and the monosymmetrical T sections. For our tub girder, the only way to calculate the M critic value is through a buckling analysis, and for this, MIDAS can help. We prepared a model of the tub girder we talked about. We import the section, in this case, from AutoCAD as a line element, and then we extruded it to realize the girder as a plate element. It's important to create a plate element because with a line one, we cannot catch all the possible deformation on the beam. We applied the boundary, so you can see it here on display. We apply in a way coherent with the original model. We assign the steel S355 as material, and we define the thickness of the flanges and of the webs. Then we applied on the top flanges a notional load that we call the buckling, which is a 10 kN per meter per square meter load. And we extend the analysis to 10 modes here in analysis buckling. We choose 10 modes, adding the buckling load to the list. We already can give a look to results. We first check the moment associated with the load we apply in results. Forces, plate, forces, moment. Buckling is the load we need, and we choose the normal forces. And now we're gonna choose, for example, a central section of the girder. We isolate it. In this way, we can calculate the resultant bending moment, multiplying the forces with the distance from the center of section. Okay, having this moment, bending moment, we have to multiply it for the critical load factor that we can find in mode shapes, buckling mode shape. Here we have each mode analyzed. We can see different one, for example. Okay, this is the first one. On the right, we can see the critical load factor for this mode. And also we have the next modes. Okay, this the minimum critical load factor of all modes that usually is associated to the first vibration mode, first buckling mode, has to be multiplied by the reference moment that we calculated, gives and giving us the elastic critical moment we looked for. Well, also the second model is gone. Now we're gonna introduce the last one. For making viable the single tab gear resolution, we needed an excavation at the level of a lower national road of 15 centimeters. This made the second proposed solution not applicable due to logistical problems and to the excessive costs required for the work. To rise above the situation, a double tab section has been proposed and accepted. This solution has an high cost and weight, but gives the possibility to reduce the height of the deck package. Furthermore, to respect the available clearance requirement, we need to slightly modify the configuration of the intersection, achieving a reduction of the central span to 40 meters length. In this third model, phases of execution will be analyzed. This kind of analysis is crucial for bridges, since the way you plan to build a bridge can change in a significant way the resultant stresses in the elements. A delicate stage for composite bridges is the casting of the slab. In this phase, the deck is only metallic, so we can have various issues that will be ignored without studying step by step the structure. For example, the buckling problem previously analyzed. The error code 116 prescribes some loads to consider for the casting phase. Mainly, we have the weight of the fluid concrete, the presence of workers and facilities, and formworks. This can be theoretically considered as a moving load because we don't know the most onerous position for the working area. In MIDAS, we could do this, converting this moving load in a static load through a specific function. Finally, we give a look to load combination considered in the model. Here we will show the error code 0, ultimate limit state fundamental combination, and seismic combination. Here we have the combination coefficients for road bridges from the NXA1. Also, thermal uniform actions and gradients need to be combined between them using the factor provided by error code 15 and the national annex. Furthermore, the main direction of seism, marked as A in the seismic combination, are applied at the same time according to error code 8. Okay, now we go in the MIDAS model. Here is the mode. Piers are realized with a line element with a section variable in both directions. We need to create a temporary group here. Four tapered group for each pier to make the shape in the right way, since we have many elements to manage together. In this model, we used a non-common composite section that has been created with a specific tool of MIDAS, that is the sectional property calculator, and then imported as a sec file. Here we can see, for example, here is the section import. Here now we can see how it appears. Okay. This is the main beam, one of the two main beams. The slab is modeled with a plate element. Ball, okay, so we can see the wall structure. This is a slab, it's a plate element, and this is done for a more accurate distribution of applied loads on it. For this reason, in this case, the moving load optimization has been done with a traffic load lane, traffic surface lane. Okay, this is already done. We have always a carriageway of 4.5 meters. We still use the load model provided by Eurocodes, and we created all load cases that we needed. These are the vehicles, load model 1, load model 2, and the moving load cases are characteristic frequent and load model 2. In this model, some loads along with traffic 1 have been applied as a surface load. As we can see, for example, for sidewalks, that is an edge surface load, and the action of the wheeling surface of the pavement. The loads in phase of execution are instead the beam loads. We created the concrete, the fluid concrete, that are applied directly on beams, and the cube construction, that is the weight of the workers in casting phase. We applied this load directly on beams because in the phase when they are activated, the slab is not active at all. The one relative to the workers in our case was very simple because having the minimum value of the expression for calculate the load, we have a uniform distributed load of 0.75 kilonewton per square meter, distributed equally between the two beams. Since the structure is a part of a bigger viaduct, the half lateral spans that we don't analyze are simulated with a nodal force. Okay, we can see here the load called here. We applied it on a node located where the support is supposed to be, and the node is connected to the pier with an elastic rigid link. That okay. Now we analyze the construction stages. We have a first stage of the duration of 30 days. That is the time needed by the concrete to reach its resistance and became an effective element. In this phase, piers are built and the other spans of the viaduct are installed. We activated the piers elements, fixes at the base as boundary, and the group of load zero, that is composed by self weight and the weight of the lateral spans. In stage zero, in stage zero, we plan to cast the concrete of the slab. We have all metallic elements we activated, with activating also the links between the deck and the piers. The load activated our group of load one, including fluid concrete weight and the load due to workers. In the stage one, we can activate the slab as an element, and we can deactivate the loads of group one, activating instead the loads relative to the sidewalk on the last day in this case. Finally, in stage two, we set a duration of 100 years to see the effect of long terms. And in addition, we apply the wearing circle load of the group 2. Well, time-dependent effects has to be taken into account, especially for sections with parts in class 3 or 4, and for SLS checks. Since in these cases, elastic analysis is required, and so the history of construction stages has an effect on final stresses. The time-dependent effects for the concrete can affect the deformations like creep and shrinkage and the resistance with the increasing of compression strength in the first days after casting. We can find the laws and define this phenomena in properties here. Going in pre-shrinkage menu, we have already defined one law for our concrete 37. We choose the code we want to refer. In our case, we choose European, and entering the FCK of the material and the humidity or other than the notional size of the member, we have defined the relation, except for the age of beginning of shrinkage. Here, according to error code 4 part 2, this duration is, this age is 1 day. And now we can show results and check the function rule. We have defined also the increasing of compression strength here, choosing always error code as European code and entering, in this case, the FCM value. Here is the graph already drawn. And we see that we reach the full resistance practically in 30 days. Finally, we assign the time-dependent functions to our material with the material function. It's already defined. Then we check the properties of the composite section during construction stages. Here we have the two beams, the two main beams. Here, practically, we choose to activate the concrete part of this section in stage one, and to avoid that the simultaneous presence of this part and of this slab element brings us to a double stiffness, we eliminated here in scale factor the torsional inertia in transversal direction IXX. Okay, so we go to apply the same for the left beam. Then the error code for part 2 provides that for continuous bridges, due to the negative moment on supports that cracks the tensed concrete, we have to not consider the stiffness of the slab of the 15% of the span on each side of internal supports. Then we are going to assign a zero stiffness for these elements that we see here. Through the plate stiffness scale factor, we defined also a stiffness reduction plate boundary group, and we put zero on all these factors. This boundary group is useful to define for which load cases here in analysis boundary change assignments we are going to apply these modifiers. In this case, for example, we exclude the response spectrum analysis since it would not properly work otherwise, but we activate it for static load cases and moving load cases, as you can see here. So now it's time to check some results. In first place, we can check the construction stages if they work properly. Okay, we control that for each stage there are activated appropriate loads. Here we can see the first stage with only pyres activated. Here we have the metallic elements activated. In stage one we have also the slab active, and we can see all loads applied. And in stage two we have, this is the final stage, we have everything we need activated. The other loads automatically apply in the post-construction stages phase. Now, a little trick to save time when we need to create the load combination. You can see here we have any combination. The way is to take them from an existing file at the condition of using the same load cases names. For example, we have this existing file. It's an old file of another bridge, and we can export it in MCT file, that is the textual form of the MIDAS file. We save it, and we go find the load combinations here. We simply copy, and going back to the other model, we do paste in the MCT command shell window. We go run. And now we have all load combination already defined. Here we can check that we have done all we said in slides. For example, we have all traffic groups group 1A, group 1B, group 2. We have the envelope of all traffic loads. Then we have the ultimate limit state combination. We have, for example, the combination between the thermal loads here, combined with wind in both directions, and with traffic and the summation of the stresses of the construction stages. Then we have the seismic combinations for the three main directions, and the envelope of all seismic loads, seismic combination. Well, now we can see the traffic load effect in the moving tracer. Reinforces moment. Okay, we choose an element for the central span, for example, the 121. And here we can see the load distribution for maximize the LM1 characteristic. We see that in this case we haven't line loads, but they are surface loads. We can, for example, see the minimum. Okay, and we see that it's coherent. And also, for example, we can see the effect on a side span. For example, for the element 45, this is the minimum, and this is the maximum value for element 1. It seems coherent. Then we inactivate the group no stiffness, because this they don't allow us to see real deformations. And then we give a look to the summation load for each stage. For example, we go in beam positive mode. Okay, we go in the first phase, it appears. Here we have only normal forces acting. Okay, then we can see for the stage zero, that is the phase when we have to activate the beams and the cross beams. For example, we can see the moment. Okay. Then we have the stage one with the head of the slab. And finally, we have the stage two with that is final stage with also the pavement added. So we can see in the post-construction stages the load combination we define. For example, we can see the envelope of the ultimate limit state combination. Okay, and also the seismic envelope. So this was the last solution proposed and finally accepted by the client for the realization of the road passage. As we have seen, MIDAS gave us the possibility to have a complete overview of different solutions, giving many options to choose the level of accuracy that we want to reach with our models, and having the flexibility to explore many solutions to find the most efficient. So, I thank you for the attention. If you have any questions, please contact MIDAS Bridge at midasit.com. Thanks for watching.